And that's when I knew I actually need help. And if I don't do something about this, I'm gonna end up sacrificing my actual health and well-being for my job, and there will be no longevity for any of this.
Alyson, welcome to POVs. You're one of my favorite people in the world, and having you here in person on the couch is everything to me, so thank you so much for coming.
Everything you just said back to you.
How you feeling? How's your week?
Oh, the week has been a pretty steady rhythm, and I just traveled overnight, so I'm fresh off the plane and ready to chat.
Love it. I think some of the best conversations happen on very little sleep, so this is going
to
be great.
You just pierce right through the level of facade and go straight to authenticity.
Which is what we are all about. So Perfect. Let's dive in. Every episode here on POVs, I always start off with somewhat of a controversial question to kick us off. So you ready?
Great, sure.
We're diving right in.
Okay.
Alyson.
Sophie.
Do you think child celebrities are inherently destined for disaster?
Whew. I think when you have infrastructure in place, in systems, and it has gone unchecked and unexamined, while we have, since their development, learned so much about human psychology, human well-being, I think if you don't heartily examine the system, there will inevitably be a predisposition to increased suffering and potentially even problematic behavior, because it's by design. And that's not to excuse or justify behavior. Total support and taking responsibility for the impact of your choices and how you spend your time, where you invest your energy. And when you have a child who's never had a blueprint for the world, experiencing reality for the first time in such a chaotic and unusual set of circumstances, you will likely see some kind of unusual behavior as a response.
Yeah, and
boom, first question.
I was gonna say, let's examine the system.
Yikes.
When was the first time that you remember feeling that you were inside the toddler to train wreck pipeline?
So while you're on the hamster wheel, very rarely are you able to pause, because my friend says there's no neutral place on a moving train, right? So we're going, and there aren't folks saying, hey, take a beat and let's really reflect and see that your health is deteriorating, or notice that you've been socialized in these ways where you can't relate to your peers, but you can relate to seven men in business suits. And, you know, notice that you're afraid of building authentic relationships because you have to maintain a certain image and reputation. There's no time to do any of that self-work and self-development. So usually it's not until you have physical symptoms that you need to address, or you start acting out. A lot of people, you know, talk about toddlers turning into the train wreck. And for me, it was the former. So I became obsessive about what I was consuming food-wise. I was tracking all of my exercise. And at the heart of it, I really just wanted to be my personal best. But suddenly, over time, the things I was trying to control started controlling me. And that's when I knew I actually need help. And if I don't do something about this, I'm gonna end up sacrificing my actual health and well-being for my job, and there will be no longevity for any of this.
Yeah, wow. I can't imagine being in the hamster wheel and on it and being able to actually understand what's happening in the moment. And I've understood, you know, from reading the op-ed that you wrote for People and in the video series you created, that maybe it took checking yourself into rehab in order to get the help you needed. Was that the first point in which you finally started weaning off the hamster wheel to address the feelings you were feeling?
You know, as a child, I've always been a seeker type, so I always wanted to research any new topic. I used to ask my teachers for extra credit book reports.
Amazing. Like, I'm not surprised.
I would watch a special on Oprah on, you know, my family's TV, and I'd go to school and say, Mrs. Novacek, spelled N-O-W-A-C-C-Y-K, third grade, remember that. I want to deliver a report to the class about this topic. And so what was bittersweet is when I was on the hamster wheel, I had all of these untapped areas, interests, potential, desires. And so they were just kind of under the radar, right? They're just dormant. And I think at some point when I checked myself into rehab, it was a chance for all of those pieces to come forward and for, you know, professionals to say, hey, you've got all of these elements, all these dimensions to who you are as a human. What if we actually allowed space for all of them to come forward and you were able to integrate them into a more whole sense of being? Then what would you choose? And, you know, I get chills thinking about it because in my heart of hearts, I always knew I had way more to offer the world than just performing on camera. Mm-hmm. And it's not to say that I don't enjoy it or see the value in impactful storytelling. It's to say, by design, that researcher really wanted to also go get some certifications on the mind-body connection.
Yeah.
That inner student wanted to go study contemplative mysticism. Those other elements wanted to come forward and then say, okay, now how do I want to tackle, you know, my life path, my career path? And it was so scary to let go of an identity that had formed so early and had been validated by millions of people. You know, there's this fear for anyone who has momentum in their career. Once you lose it, you're on, you know, you're right on trend to becoming a, you know, you're forgotten, and then you have to make a comeback. And you know, it's silly because in reality, now with my company, Movement Genius, I feel that I'm able to make a much more whole contribution to the world, even though it might not be celebrated in the same standards of fame and Hollywood status.
Totally hear that. And you are. I think it's interesting hearing about that piece of your childhood and seeing how you continue to be a student of life in the work that you do. And we'll get to Movement Genius, but it's interesting hearing a little bit more about maybe some of the pressure you felt within the industry at such a young age. Did you ever feel at a crossroads that maybe it was actually easier to stay on the hamster wheel than to hop off?
Totally. Yes. I wanted to step away for 10 years before I actually did. Mm. I knew that I wanted to face the fear of letting go of that identity. And for some, they're able to actually evolve within the industry and not have to make such a, you know, concrete decision to step away entirely. For me, I knew that I would be holding on to some familiar comforts, and I really just wanted to do some deeper work, some deeper healing. Yeah. And so it took a long time, especially because once you've started working for one thing and it starts, you know, coming to fruition, you're like, why would I give up the thing I dedicated 20 plus years of my life to?
Yeah.
And the thing that by our societal standards is successful. And so, you know, in so many ways, I had to grapple with the fact that I wanted to pursue normalcy and being average. And that to me was special. And I knew it was not going to be the same way that other people saw it, but it was so important. Like, I can't tell you how grateful I am that I just installed a ceiling fan on my own. Like, that was the highlight. Yeah, people are like, tell me your biggest accomplishment today. And I was like, I ran 3 errands yesterday. So
I totally relate to that. And it's really amazing sitting with you here now and seeing how you have gotten to this place of a little bit more normalcy and living a life that you truly want to live with meaning and purpose. And so much of why I admire you, Alyson, is because you're unafraid to use your voice. And though it may have taken you 10 years to get out of the industry, you are living and breathing that example of what it means to actually advocate for what you truly want and need and how to use your voice for good. And in that moment when you were ready to jump off the hamster wheel, maybe it was checking into rehab, maybe it was seeking normalcy to what that meant to you at the time, what were you feeling in that moment and what inevitably pushed you to actually use your voice?
Oh man, there are several dips, and I don't think that, you know, catalysts for growth always have to be something negative or tragic. However, in my case, you know, some call it a dark night of the soul. I think my health was the first loud siren. And then a second loud siren was when I realized I was attracted to women. And that came with a huge process of deconstructing my worldview at that point, my understanding of faith and love and all of these things that just, you know, started unraveling before me. And I remember a distinct moment. I had been, you know, removed from my faith community because of my attraction, even though I was trying to, at that point, heal from it would be the term at that point that removed. I would use. Yes. So I was no longer permitted to be in the community. And parents, I used to teach kids dance, and some of the parents thought I was no longer safe to be near their children, as if it was contagious or something. And so I remember being in my room, and I broke down, and I remember kind of, you know, looking up to the sky and just saying, like, if I'm fundamentally broken and wrong, I've tried so hard to change it, I think I have to accept that I'm gonna go to hell. I'm not gonna make it. I think I've gotta accept that. It's not what I expected. I really wanted to do my best. And interestingly, in that moment of thinking it would be total darkness, I felt this peace for the first time that like filled the entire room. And it was almost like I got my first glimpse of what true love actually feels like. Acceptance, compassion, honesty. And somehow I knew, okay, this is gonna be really hard. There's gonna be a period where the people in my life who have been pillars might fall away. My career might change. You know, I had my team saying, you're not gonna book work. At that time, you know, they weren't seeking queer people to play roles or check the box of inclusion. Whatever that honest place was alive and vibrant. And so I was like, all right, I'm just gonna start there and let that guide the path, because I don't know what else to do. I've tried everything else.
Yeah.
Those were some of the feelings. And I, again, it doesn't have to be that dramatic, but in my case, it did feel like a ground zero.
Almost like survival too. Like in that moment, all you can do is find a way to put one foot in front of the other. How would you define the chapter between that moment and now arriving at your purpose with Movement Genius?
So I think there is a theme of reclaiming my own voice. So I had to figure out first, what is my voice?
Yeah.
Because I've only been a mouthpiece for other people's scripts or for society's standards, whatever it is. I've just been regurgitating other worldviews, and I haven't really etched my own. And so it was a blend of research. It was reaching out to, you know, mentor figures, leaders. I consider certain authors, even though I've never met them, to be mentors. Books are sort of my go-to, but it can be any, you know, source of information for everyone. And so it was, you know, a process of taking in new points of view and wrestling, doing a lot of healing. So looking at some of the wounds, you know, I've been in therapy for a long time and can't, you know, support it enough. A little tangent on that note, if you're going to therapy, finding, you know, an alliance with your therapist, making sure they're culturally competent, making sure they actually are, you know, the right fit for what you need is super crucial.
Yeah.
And so I think there was a process of reclaiming my voice. And then there was also a process of empowerment, daring to believe that something I come up with from my own perspective is good enough to share it with the world and be seen the same way my old projects were when I had huge companies backing them. And so building that, you know, trust and like chutzpah, I don't know what else you'd call it, to go and produce my own content, witnessing you and your team creating this in the community, like, this is also what I did my version of, because I said, I've got something to say, and I know no one else is going to do it for me, so I will create it. I will trust that I can study, do my best, and catch a wave and figure it out, grow along the way as needed, ask for help as needed. And so I started scaling my own digital content platforms. And I think once I saw that people actually cared what I had to say, I was like, oh, you're telling me we didn't need the middleman this whole time? Like, what was that about? So, you know, finding your voice and self-empowerment, I think were the two themes.
I find that sometimes when you find that match between what you truly believe in and what you actually want to say, you find your people. So I feel like in a way you found the right community mm-hmm. and the right space for you to be your full self.
Yeah.
And something you shared, I think, resonates, especially with me, but I'm sure our entire community, which was for so much of your life, your views weren't necessarily your own.
Right.
Being a mouthpiece, amplifying what other people want you to say instead mm-hmm. of what you actually want to say. What would you say to a young person out there who's feeling something similar, that maybe they only believe what they're being told at their dinner tables or from their families or even just their environments that they're brought up in? How do you separate the two, and how do you start figuring out what you truly believe?
Sure. Well, of course, when we're growing up, we are a sum total of the experiences of the people around us and their points of view. And so if you're having moments of feeling ashamed about that, or you find yourself criticizing yourself, if possible, you know, I invite you to take a step back and witness that that's how human brains work. There's no shame in, you know, having a computer up here doing its best to protect you and survive, to make sense of the world, and to find the most efficient ways to say, oh yeah, I've been here before, this is what's gonna happen, and this is how it goes. So, you know, have some compassion and patience. And then, of course, the next step is curiosity, right? It's to approach everything with an open mind and non-judgment, and to say, that's so interesting. I wonder where this thought originated. How old was I when I first started, you know, thinking this thought? And, you know, some therapeutic techniques, of course, can be helpful. But, you know, once you start to notice the story that drives you on a daily basis, then you can remember you actually have agency to become the writer of the story. So instead of being either a victim in your own story, or feeling like it's being written for you and you have no power or say, here's where you actually get to pick up the pen and ask yourself, you know, what are my values? And I think something that's helpful as you're developing your point of view is to remember that as new information comes in, that perspective is going to evolve. So it's not about, you know, jumping from one thing to the next and gluing yourself to it. It's actually, in my process and opinion, there is resilience and wisdom in learning how to continually, more fluidly and dynamically play with ideas, hold them while they're, you know, beneficial and effective and helpful, and then when they need to be reworked and remolded, letting yourself continually re-sculpt. I think that's like, maybe that's just because I never want to find myself not knowing what to do. So I'm like, you know, stay flexible, yeah. Stay fluid.
I love how you presented not only that our views can be molded. I think so often we get stuck in our own ways, but even knowing that what comes in can also keep moving, and
we
as
have
you grow.
To.
Exactly.
Like we actually need to do that.
Yeah.
Because there are so many things I've internalized that are not true about myself and other people that I need to let them pass through and get reshaped.
Yeah, it's also like emotions, like being able to hold them and also know that it may evolve or change or mm-hmm. shift. And so that married with agency, I think, is huge.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for sharing that. I think a lot of us get stuck in those stories we tell ourselves and forget that we have the agency to pick up the pen and turn the page. Yeah. And it's not always as easy as that, but such an important reminder.
Yeah.
So thank you for sharing that.
Finding some of those techniques that are helpful are crucial to implement just into your daily practices or as you're going about whatever is on your schedule, to be able to check in, become aware, consider what story's playing out, check the validity, maybe try reframing it, you know, and start playing with what's happening up here, which also will impact, will have an effect on how you're feeling, you know, physiologically as well.
Completely.
Which we can get into.
Totally. And Alyson, thinking back to some of those moments in your life where you were in your bedroom, maybe in an audition, on set, and feeling that this world that you were in was inescapable, what would you want younger Alyson to know here in 2022, celebrating over a year of building movement genius and truly living out your values and your mission of creating mindful movement for mental health?
Wow. I think first I would want young Alyson to know that even though lots of folks have sipped the Kool-Aid of Hollywood being the coolest thing ever, life is way more interesting outside of Hollywood. and then second, I would want her to know that all of the qualities she had innately that were swept under the rug are actually her superpowers, and, you know, hold some keys to finding, you know, the best use of my time and energy and effort.
A message that so many people need to hear, that really what we are trying to stay away from are the parts that we so vehemently reject about ourselves, are quite literally the pieces of ourselves that we need to embrace. Mm.
I mean, yes. Like, on that note, a lot of us, it's natural, especially in a society where we don't ever want to come across as weak, or we don't want to ever come across as wrong. We tend to suppress certain emotions or opinions. And I understand there's a function to that. Like, if we were all just running around being like, I'm actually feeling this way, it might be a lot.
Yeah.
However, those pieces of us that we reject, or that we ridicule, or that we are afraid of, just because we try to suppress them doesn't mean they've actually gone anywhere, right? So they will only later manifest as maybe physical pains or illness or challenges in relationships. Mm. And so being able to face those parts with love and compassion, I mean, really, the sooner you start doing that work, I know it's uncomfortable, so there's a process of learning how to sit with discomfort here. But the sooner you start doing that, the sooner you're able to really stand in all kinds of moments and feel like, okay, I'm equipped to manage this, and I can find clarity in the decision I want to make. Otherwise, those parts of you are still unconsciously kind of running the show.
Absolutely. And so much of the work you do now is in the mental health space. And so much of what you just shared, I think, relates to that. Being able to take care of yourself and your voice and your mental health, to be able to withstand different scenarios and moments throughout your life by preventing the fire before it starts. Mm-hmm. What do you wish young people understood more about mental health?
I wish when we talked about mental health that we recognized it's not just in our heads. Our stress, anxiety, even trauma is stored in our bodies as well. So most mental health solutions focus neck up, and you might be reframing thoughts, and that's helpful. However, if your body is still feeling overwhelmed or disconnected or stuck in some pattern, it's not gonna find that peace, right? And that grounding until you work with your body. Mm. And so when we talk about feeling better on a mental health level, the reason my company, Movement Genius, has full body techniques, stress relief, relaxation, movement programs, is because that mind-body connection means you can more fully address those symptoms of stress and suffering. And then over time, not only does it help in that moment to feel more balanced, but over time, you actually start retraining your nervous system. So the things that used to be considered triggers or things that activated you might actually become more manageable. And as someone who has, you know, been diagnosed with an anxiety disorder, I don't know how many years ago, and has taken time and steps to really practice these skills that we have on the platform, I have a noticeable difference in my everyday experience. And for me, it's not just, oh, thankfully I didn't feel as panicky. It's also, I actually felt empowered enough to go and say hi to someone I normally wouldn't have. I actually feel confident enough to start the company and be a co-founder, to take on responsibilities that before just would have felt like too much to handle.
Yeah.
So, you know, really including the body, understanding where you carry stress, and learning to communicate with the body and your mind, I think can make a huge difference.
Huge. Coming from someone who loves your At Your Desk series.
Yay.
I'm behind a desk all day, every day. So thank you for creating a platform with your sister to really empower.
Shout out to Corey.
That really empowers young people in a way that I think you're right, isn't being talked about enough. That we have to connect the mind and the body in order to actually make some sort of movement within ourselves. So thank you.
Yeah, I mean, because imagine you start saying all of your affirmations, but your body is going, there's a bear coming at you, there's a bear coming at you. So now you've got a mind-body disconnect.
Yeah.
So you've got two different stories going on, which can make it even more frustrating. Because you're like, body calm down. And your body's like, I don't operate in logic. I don't speak that language. I'm in survival mode.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, it's not just when we think about wellness and well-being, I think sometimes we only imagine someone who, you know, does yoga and meditation and is super flexible and sits cross-legged and drinks green smoothies. And really, it's about that empowering process of going, I understand what's going on right now and what my unique mind and body need to manage this moment.
And it's different for everyone.
And it's different for everyone.
So thank you for creating Movement Genius. I'm the biggest fan of the community you're building, and you and Corey, and I'm just so grateful to be a part of it.
Thank you.
So now, Alyson, I want to bring us to my favorite segment here on POVs, where we're going to start bringing in some viewpoints from the larger Gen Z community.
Okay.
So keep an eye on your phone. We're going to send you some texts, and I want your raw, unfiltered answers to these POVs.
All right.
Let's do it. It's a little spicy.
Imagine being rich and famous, but claiming victimhood. Okay.
Whew. What are your thoughts?
So my first thought is that makes so much sense. And yes, I absolutely hear where you're coming from. I would like to propose a couple of points. The first being, as a society, we have done a phenomenal job at creating this thing called the illusion of separation, right? Where famous people are seen in the hierarchy almost as, you know, better than, or we're aspiring towards something, as well as this illusion of separation where, because we're, you know, umpteen degrees of separation from each other, it's easier to dehumanize and to think, yeah, no, they've got access, therefore they should be fine. So the other aspect is when you're on the inside of the industry, it looks wildly different from the veneer that we work so hard
right.
to create and maintain. When I say we, I mean the industry. I don't know if I really want to like be a part of that. You know, if this is directed to me personally, of course, I always want to just have a conversation. If I'm reading the subtext of this, of like, ugh, come on. I agree that the ugh, come on should be dealt with as an ugh, come on should be dealt with. And let's expand our understanding and awareness of what's going on.
Absolutely. That's such an important perspective.
Don't just tell me to go on a walk. Getting up and moving around isn't going to cure my depression. It's just not. My first response is, it seems like there's legitimate struggle. And again, I want to say you're right. If that feels like that's not helpful for you, then don't do it. It's not about prescribing a one-size-fits-all. It's about reminding you that you deserve to feel safe and comfortable and confident in your mind and body. And if you have things that are causing struggles in that area, what can we do to support you? So maybe it might be a walk at some point. Maybe today it's just saying nothing is working and practicing acceptance. But whatever it is, it's important to remember that there is hope and there are options. You can get creative with what wellness and self-care look like for you. But it moves me to read this because in some of my lower moments, sometimes the last thing you want to do or feel like you can do is move your body. So I have compassion.
Thank you for sharing that. I think what you're doing is so important because you're not necessarily saying movement is a one size fits all. It's something to try. It's something to try on. And I'm sure in some of those darkest moments, it can feel really tough to get up and move. And I just love that you're able to hold space for every single person's unique experience.
Yeah. And these are tools, right? We need as many tools as we can so that when you reach this moment, you go, all right, it's a no for a walk, but it's a yes to journaling. Mm-hmm. Or it's a no for a walk, but it's a yes to a nap and then a yes to a walk. So it's really just breaking down whatever feels too big into the smallest step that feels like you can manage.
Completely.
I can't believe that Disney Channel stars singing Send It On didn't actually solve climate change.
Oh my gosh, do you remember that?
Yeah, I don't think was I in that one? I don't think I was in that one.
But do you remember watching it?
Oh, do I remember watching it?
Did you feel empowered and ready to change the world?
Oh, I don't want to ruin this for people, but when we had a schedule full of press and promo, I don't think any of us were actually, I can't speak for others, I don't think I was fully aware of what we were discussing. Mm-hmm. It was more of a performance and making sure I showed up on time and did my job precisely. Now that there's like platforms like yours where we're actually going straight to what's going on, I think I can more fully participate. That's the like shaky ground of using media to discuss important topics. It very easily gets, you know, it loses substance and depth and legitimacy. But there are, like you, wonderful places that are merging the two, impact and media.
Have you seen the industry or even particularly Disney evolve since your time at the network? Do you feel like they are taking steps to address important issues?
I actually haven't turned on Disney Channel for
don't watch TV.
It's what, 15 years. So I don't know what's going on. I also, yes, don't have a TV or any streamers, so I don't really know what movies are out.
That's fair.
But internally, I've heard of some strides to support the artists on set in terms of mental health. I think we can always do better.
For sure. I think we all can. And thinking back on your time in a lot of these popular entertainment shows and franchises, is there any character that you've portrayed over time that you felt was closely connected to who you are?
I mean, aside from, of course, you're always pulling from pieces of yourself because that's kind of what you have to work with. I think I loved playing Isabella on Phineas and Ferb because she was such a go-getter and so organized. So maybe she was kind of aspirational. And then I played it, the film never came out. In fact, I was hoping it was going to be my breakout role. Womp womp. And I played more of a zany, spontaneous, she was more comedically inclined than a lot of my other roles. And it gave me a chance to be silly in a way that not many people experience me until we're like, you know, really like family. So yeah, I like when those pieces kind of
I'm sad it never came out. I would have loved to see it.
We had to go skydiving for the end credits, and we didn't know until 3 days before.
They made you skydive, and then they didn't put it out?
I know, right? They said, can you sign this waiver? And I thought, you mean you're not getting stunt doubles? You're actually risking the two leads going skydiving right now?
That is wild.
This is great.
Sure. Probably got you out of your comfort zone.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. On the flip side, is there a character that you've portrayed that you felt the least connected to?
Yes. The show's not out yet, but I guess I can't really say much about it other than I've never been the quote-unquote bad guy before. And it doesn't mean I don't have those parts of me, but, you know, they're just not really my... I wouldn't approach situations like they do.
I can't wait to see it.
Yeah. But it's okay. Fun. I get to make a lot of interesting fight noises. Everyone hates on... Do you like how I had to do a deep sigh?
You already know what this one's about, so...
Like holding on to the back of his couch. Everyone hates on brands who show support during Pride or even during Mental Health Awareness Month by saying they're just profiting off of these communities, but at least they're doing something, right? It's life, so it's complex. It's not gonna be black and white. There are probably people within the company who are there for certain intentions that are in support of the community. Probably folks within the company who are also there for a little bit of profit, a little bit of strategy, marketing play. And within each of us, there are parts of me when I know as a queer person, if I'm able to have a campaign that helps fund my company and you just so happen to want me because it's Pride Month, that does serve a functional purpose. Instead of me saying, no, you're only doing this because I'm queer right now, and then not being able to fund my company. So, you know, it's complicated. I think that calls us to check in very regularly. Mm-hmm. And what might be a yes today could be a no tomorrow. And you sort of see the track record of brands. You can kind of tell when they're really about it. However, if there's enough support towards a movement, even the people who jumped on just because it seemed popular can still help build awareness, right? So, you know, they might be showing up just because they want to look cute in their rainbow overalls. And those overalls might be the reason that, you know, Grandma June somewhere was like, hey, you know, grandniece, I see you're wearing those same rainbow overalls. Let's chat. So, like, you know.
Yeah, can be a conversation starter.
There you go, yeah.
It could lead to something that we don't know, but holding space for all of those different realities.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be muddy. Like,
and it's not perfect.
No. Have you seen the state of the world? Like, I dare you to go try and do something that has impact without getting messy. Let me know how it goes. And if you figure out a way, like, please let us know. Why do I need a therapist if I can just talk to my friends? It's way too expensive anyways, and once I vent and let it out, I feel better. So I'm catching a couple of things. First, affordability. Valid. Therapy has notoriously been inaccessible and incompetent. Thankfully, there are platforms that have like formal clinical therapy. And then there also are preventative mental health solutions. Movement Genius, I think, would fall into the category of being able to support your mental health. And then this component of once I vent and let it out, I feel better. So you might have processed that in the moment, in the short term. But unless your friends are clinically trained to listen to patterns over time, you might not arrive at that self-awareness as soon to be able to say, you know, what's interesting is every time before this big test comes around in school, I seem to have these really negative thoughts. Instead, it might just be, I'm having the negative thoughts again. Whereas someone who's trained to really listen attentively and has tools to help you manage can help build a much deeper self-awareness and can also inspire new questions and considerations that might end up like really significantly changing the trajectory of your life. Like, you might have some realizations in a therapeutic setting where, you know, you go in thinking you're going left, you come out, you go right, and like your life is doing a 180. So fully support deep conversation with friends. Like, that's beautiful if you have that.
And that's an important reminder. I think that's something I didn't necessarily learn until later in life. And I definitely hear a lot of where that person is coming from.
Yeah. Venting is not the same as cognitive behavioral therapy.
For sure.
You know, there's a lot. It might, the appearance, maybe that's what it is. The appearance might look similar, just two people chatting. But what's happening underneath that conversation, the therapist is doing some pretty incredible mental gymnastics.
Yeah.
To really make that a comprehensive catalyst for your transformation. Alyson Stoner is my role model. She showed me it was actually possible to heal your inner child. Okay.
<It's> so sweet.
Well, if it's real, that's really kind, and I'm so glad. I'm just a mirror, right? Or I'm a canvas and I'm like trying to paint whatever picture I can of my own healing. And then, you know, as a mirror, give people a chance to say, it's actually okay to look inward. This exists in a very special, deep place when I know that it is then having an impact on their own well-being.
I feel so lucky to be watching your journey. You've also shown me that that's possible, and you are such a special person. And before you go, one message for all of Gen Z.
What?
If I gave you a megaphone and it would reach every person in this generation, what would you want them to know?
What's coming to mind is really examining our own biases. I would encourage Gen Z to examine your own bias so that when we come together for these conversations and we reimagine a new world and actually start building it, that from the ground up, we're approaching it thoughtfully, from a heart-centered place, from a human well-being-centered place, from an inclusive, accessible place, that we have to build for everyone as a baseline. That's the bare minimum. That's not us, like, being heroic or progressive because we're thinking about people who are different from us and how they would interact with this product. Like, the baseline is, how can we make sure as many people as possible have access and can utilize this product in a way that meets them exactly where they are in their embodiment, in their, you know, identity, background.
I love that.
Which I feel like you already do.
And what you do. That's also why I so admire how you've built Movement Genius, because in a way it really mirrors the unified world that I pray we can create down the road. So thank you, Alyson, for...
We gotta pray with our feet.
Amen. Alyson, thank you for everything you do, for being a unifier, for being someone who uses her voice without fear of judgment, and for truly being here on POVs today to empower not only myself, but so many people who are going to listen to this conversation.
Thank you. It's the best first stop ever.
Bring it in. Thank you so much for doing this.
Wow, we've come a long way. I didn't used to hug people.
Oh my gosh. I hope it's okay that yes. I hugged you.
Yes, totally.
And let's also take a quick selfie.
Okay.
How you feel?
Oh, how do I look?
You're so great.
Just like a vulnerable blob.
I was crying there with you, so we are in this together.
It's just because I have nasal congestion. That's what's coming out of my eyes. It's not tears of emotion.